You're listening to The Hour of the Time. I'm William Cooper. Tonight, the fourth evening with Mr. A. Ralph Epperson. Strikes back.
That's what we're doing, Bill. We're striking back at the Empire.
We're going to continue with what we were doing last night, folks, and we're going to continue to do it on Monday night, and that Monday night will be the last night with Ralph Epperson, and I really hope that you've all enjoyed his visit with us. Of course, he's going to be here one more night, Monday night. I want to urge you to send for his catalog. Send a number 10 self-addressed stamped envelope to Ralph, Post Office Box 536, Tucson, Arizona, 85702. I'm going to repeat this during the program, but one more for right now. Ralph, Post Office Box 536, Tucson, Arizona, 85702. Of course, you know that it's on the hotline in case you didn't have time to write it down during this program. And those of you out there who do not have a pad of paper and a pencil or a pen by your side while you listen to The Hour of the Time, shame on you. Ralph, let's go. What goodies have you got for us tonight?
Well, what we're doing, Bill, for those who haven't heard the first three programs, is we're just reading a random sampling of quotes from the books written by the people involved in this conspiracy we're talking about. We're using their own material to prove that you and I, what we've been saying for years, is right.
And they admit it all in their own words, don't they?
That's correct. That's what we're trying to do, is document the case from their own literature, so that when we say things, we know what we're talking about because we've used their own information.
That's correct. That's the best way to do it. And for those of you who listen to this program, you know I like to do that an awful lot.
That's the only way, you know, this story is so incredible that's the only way we can survive. Who knows, Ralph Epperson? I'm nobody, but the thing that we're reading is somebody. The people that are writing the books that we're quoting from are the ones directly involved in what we've been talking about for years.
That's correct.
And so when we quote them, they are their experts. They're telling us the truth. Most people don't read this kind of material. Probably 95% of people have never heard of Rex Hutchins or Manly P. Hall or Albert Pike, but you and I know who they are because we dared to open up their material to find out what they're saying.
That's right. You said something that I think is very, very sad. Most people don't read this material, but I'll go farther than that. Since the invention and the depositing of television set in the homes of Americans, it's become true now that most people not only don't read this stuff, but they don't read it all.
Well, that's why I produce on that catalog that you're recommending your listeners to get a copy of. I've got probably 40 hours of lectures on there for you can plug it in and watch it on the TV set. So Charlie Couch Potato can sit down and watch the videos that'll do the same job the books will do.
That's right, and I've done the same thing. In fact, the only reason that I ever began producing videos is I learned from going around the country and talking to people They don't read.
No.
But you give them a videotape, they can plug into their television set, and they'll watch that. That's a sad state of affairs, because the sum total of all of the knowledge that humanity has learned throughout the thousands of years of its history is in books.
Yeah.
It's not on videotape.
Yeah, not yet, no.
You got sound bites on videotape. You don't have knowledge on videotape.
Yeah. We're working on it. Well, we have knowledge on videotapes that you and I produce.
That's correct.
I want to now prove that the Masons are out to destroy religion, family, and nationalism, etc. I'm going to use their own material once again to do this. And let's talk, Bill. I know your listeners maybe have already heard this. Once again, we're speaking not only to reinforce what they've already learned, but also to introduce the new people who are listening tonight.
Doesn't hurt for them to hear it again.
Okay, let's talk.
Many times, if necessary.
Let's talk about the ritual that the Mason goes through, and the individual known as Hiram or Hiram Abiff in their own lodges, the Masonic lodges. Now, Masons, I want to make this clear, and I know you've done it as well. I'm not a Mason. I've never been a Mason, but I have read their material. This book is written by Rex Hutchins, who at the time he wrote it was a 32nd degree Mason. Later became a 33rd. His book was published by the Supreme Council of 33rd degree, the Mother Council of the World. They're the group that leads, I believe, in their own literature, the Masons worldwide. They are the Mother Council. They published Rex Hutchins' books. I've got the book in front of me. It's entitled The Bridge to Light by Rex Hutchins. Now, let's briefly just talk briefly about Hiram and who he was, Hiram Abiff. There are two or maybe three brief mentions of him in the Old Testament about him building the Solomon's Temple. There's a King Hiram and a Hiram Abiff that appear to be two individuals in the Bible that are both mentioned.
That's right. The king was the king of Tyre, and Hiram was sent by the king of Tyre at the request of King Solomon to furnish a master builder for his efforts to build a temple.
The temple, right. Now, from those two brief mentions, two or three brief mentions of the Hiram Abiff in the Bible, the Masons have built an elaborate ceremony. You know that.
That's correct.
And they've taken not only what the Bible says, but have actually distorted what the Bible says about Hiram Abiff.
They've created a history that doesn't exist.
Exactly. Plus, they built ritual and myth on a known character in the Bible.
That's right. Because as you found out, and I know, the Hiram Abiff they're talking about in their ceremonies has really absolutely nothing to do with the real Hiram Abiff, who was the master builder who helped build the Temple of Solomon.
Now, during that, during the building of that temple, Hiram Abiff was called a master mason, according to the Masons. That means that he was the one in charge of all the apprentice masons. And the Masonic ritual teaches us that the master masons had secrets that enabled them to go from country to country without passport or without being stopped at borders. And the apprentice masons did not have those secrets, and they were somewhat confined to the working in the particular country. So according to the legend, once again, built on the basis of the true knowledge of Hiram in the Bible, they built this legend about Hiram Abiff. And I'm going to now start reading from that. Briefly, what happened, what we're going to do is we're going to examine what happened to Hiram Abiff in the writings of Rex Hutchins. Hiram was a master mason. The apprentice masons wanted his knowledge, the secrets that he contained, he had for their own purposes, and Hiram Abiff refused to give them the secrets of the of being a master mason. So in their ritual, in their myth, Hiram Abiff tries to leave the building, the temple, when it's nearly completed, and he leaves through one gate first. He's accosted by what they call three ruffians, one of the first of the three ruffians. That ruffian hits him or beats him. He survives that attack. Hiram Abiff goes out another gate of the temple. There, once again, he's met by ruffian number two. He comes back to the temple, goes out through the third gate, refuses in all three incidents to reveal the truth of the secrets. And in the third, after the third accosting, he's actually killed. Agreed?
Yes, but it's extremely important that we make it clear exactly what these wounds were. He was struck in the throat,
okay, well, let's
the back or the chest area, and then in the head.
Okay, well, we're going to read. We're going to document what that is. I'm just laying the foundation work so they know when I talk about accosted at the south gate of the temple, they know what I'm talking about. I'm
okay.
Interrupt. Now, this is from page 66 of Rex Hutchins' book entitled The Bridge to Light. Hiram we're talking about, is first accosted at the south gate of the temple, where the instrument of the attack is the rule, R-U-L-E, rule. In Greek, the word for a rule, whether a measuring instrument or a code of conduct, is canon. Thus we see the bureaucracy of the early church establishing the canon law to regulate conduct. This law was to be obeyed with unquestioned loyalty. Hence, it is an apt symbol of the suppression of freedom of speech, which might question the divinity and justice of these laws. Therefore, Hiram, with the rule, is struck where the organs of speech are, like you pointed out.
In the throat.
Now, let's examine what he just said. Who struck him? It wasn't a man. It was the church, right?
That's correct.
In other words, the church struck Hiram Abiff because it taught laws that he was that he could not question.
That's correct. Remember, folks, that these people use symbology. That is their language, and that's what Ralph is revealing to you here in this story. Go ahead, Ralph.
So the church is what the first accoster of Hiram Abiff is not a man. It is the church.
That's
right. And he's talking about a capital C church. So when this ritual was written, they're talking about the Catholic Church. That was the main church of the time. And according to the story, the Catholic Church taught law, canon law, meaning rule, that according to him had to be obeyed with unquestioned loyalty. Now let's just examine that for a minute, Bill. I used to be a Catholic, and I know that the law, the reason I'm out is because I questioned their authority. And I was free to leave the Catholic Church.
Mm-hmm.
Nowhere in Rex Hutchins' book can I find any challenge to the law that we cannot question called government. He is not upset when government really forces their law on us, and if you object, you go directly to jail. The Catholic Church has no authority to force you to be a Catholic.
That's right.
But the government has the power to force you to be a Democrat or believe in democracy or to give to welfare or to foreign aid or whatever else you have. And he's not critical of that.
No.
And in my book, I pointed out the hypocrisy of that. He's wrong. The Catholic Church has no authority to force anyone to believe in what the Catholic Church believes in.
That's
and
right.
That's millions of people all over the world are either coming in or going out of the Catholic Church daily. So Rex Hutchins shows his ignorance, in my opinion, because what he's saying is, if you want to talk about unquestioned loyalty, let's talk about government, but he doesn't do that. And that is what's wrong here. But let's go back now. So now we see that the Catholic Church is what killed Hiram Abiff, because it taught him laws that he had to obey, and that destroyed, quote, his freedom of speech, unquote. He was not able to question the laws taught by the Catholic Church.
According to him.
That's correct.
Okay,
now we're going to go to the second gate. The instrument of attack at the west gate of the temple was the square. Now, the square is a piece of metal, as you know, joined at a right angle that you see on the back of the cars of the mason. It's the square and the compass. We'll talk about the compass later. The square is two pieces of metal joined together to form a right angle you can draw straight lines with.
And that's what Bogreis is talking about when he stands up in front of a lecture hall and says, "When I raised my arm to the square." You all think that he's talking about when he took his oath of allegiance to the Constitution. It's not, folks. That's not what he means at all. Go ahead, Ralph.
Okay. So this is, in fact, he goes on to say, the square is an implement formed of two rigid pieces of metal at right angles to each other. Now, here he's going to explain that the second individual who beats up Hiram Abiff is not a man either. It, this square, represents the merger of civil and religious power intending to control man's emotions, telling him not only what he can do, but also what he can believe. Despotism, which history tells us results from this unholy merger of earthly powers, seeks to rule by dividing friends and relatives that none may unite against the tyranny. Thus Hiram is struck near the heart, the traditional seat of the affections. Now notice what he's saying here. He's saying that we should be allowed to exercise our emotions, our affections, without restraint of government or church.
But that's not really what they want at all. That's not what they believe in. They don't believe in the emotions. They believe in the supreme power of reason, according to their own writings.
But he's saying, though, that because you and I as Christians and the Catholic Church and other churches teach the controlling of your emotions, thou shalt not commit adultery, thou shalt not commit rape, thou shalt not beat thy neighbor over the head over his head, we are restricted by a God-given morality. And he's saying that this God-given morality is a restriction of mankind because we can't enjoy our affections, our emotions. Notice what's happening in America today. Young people are suddenly raping with random number. I mean, abandoned. It's happening all over. Why? Because they are being taught to enjoy their emotions with no restraints. And notice the quandary that puts the young student. He's taught in sex education that he has these physical emotions, these affections, and that there's nothing wrong with expressing them. So he grabs the little pom-pom girl, takes her in the bushes, and rapes her, and then the governor comes along and throws him in jail. He said, wait a minute, I was taught in the government school that I was to enjoy my emotions and my affections without restraint. I did so, and now you're jailing me. They're another branch of government. Mm-hmm. And he can't figure that out. And that's what Rex Hutchins is talking about here.
And that was my point, is these people are hypocrites.
Sure they are.
They're liars and hypocrites. But go ahead.
Rex Hutchins is questioning the right of us to punish rapists or murderers.
Yes.
Why? Because people are not free to enjoy their emotions, according to him. And let's go on to the
third. In their initiation, when they are initiated into the first 3 degrees, there are 3 different ceremonies, one of which the initiate raises his hand to the square, which is placed upon the Masonic Bible, and takes the oath of allegiance to the order.
That's correct. Let's go back to what the second attack, then, is really government. Now, by the way, let's talk about this, and I'm sure your listeners, I don't think a lot of people really think about this. I had a discussion tonight with a student, a young man, a student at the
Ralph, a lot of people don't think about anything. But my listeners do.
Okay. I asked him whether he believed it was important for us to punish someone who murdered somebody. He had no answer. He never thought about that before.
Uh-huh.
I said, where do we get the authority, do you believe, to punish somebody? Yeah, I don't know. I never thought about that. He never thought about that. But he wants it enforced. I said, "What would you want me to be punished if I killed your wife?" Well, sure I would. You have no right to do that. I said, wait a minute. That is a decision on your part. Where did that come from? I don't know. Why do we punish murderers? Because God commanded us to do that.
That's right.
We don't have to decide whether it's right or wrong. God told us to punish murderers and rapists and thieves and etc. But here he's saying government, no, let's go back. The reason we punish is because we have a religious view of man's right to his life, liberty, and property. And that came from God of the Bible. So here he's saying, you and I create government to protect our rights to life, liberty, and property. And he says that's a merger of civil and religious power, intending to control man's emotions. Of course it is. That's what the purpose of the law is.
If there's no control of man's emotions, we are then living according to the law of the jungle.
Exactly.
And if I'm stronger than you, I'm perfectly within my rights of putting an axe in your forehead and taking anything I want from you.
Because you are being told you can enjoy your emotions, and if it gives you pleasure to smash me in there with an axe, you can do so.
That's right.
That's what this is all about. Now notice this.
And these people really believe this, folks, until it's them that get hit in the head with the axe, and then all of a sudden, it's wrong.
Notice what I'm doing. I'm reading Rex Hutchins' book,
right,
published by the 33rd Degree Council in Washington, D.C. They published this book. This is written. It's in my. I'm writing, reading from it myself right now.
And that's the highest council of Freemasonry.
Exactly.
In the world. Not just in this country, but in the world. That is the Supreme Council.
This is absolutely mind-boggling. But this is what these people are teaching in their churches. Let's finish the last part now, the third attack. The setting maul, M-A-U-L. The setting maul is the little hammer they use when you beat, you know, masons.
That's the brick in the mortar.
Right. And it's also intended to chisel away a hammer. You know, these people believe in masonry, which means stonework. So they have a hammer that they use to cut the stone in the desired shape.
But in real reality, it has absolutely nothing to do with the real operative Freemasonry of making buildings out of stone.
No, it's right. It's making a temple out of you and I.
Yeah.
By fitting us to fit the temple. That's right. We have become the stone. They have become the workers on us. Let's finish this now. The third part of Mr. Hutchins' interpretation of this ritual of the attack of Hiram Abiff. The setting maul, meaning this hammer, an instrument of brute force, is a fitting symbol of the blind, unreasoning mob. Who's that? those who believe we should punish murderers.
That's us, folks. That's us. That's all of us, and they want to shackle us.
We're the blind, unreasoning mob. Why? Because we say punish that guy who just killed 27 people. No, wait a minute. You can't do that because he was enjoying his emotions, you see. This is what... You know, Bill, you and I are laughing, but this is serious business. This
you know,
is what
we're laughing because we understand it, and to us, this is a strange, almost insane philosophy, and it is funny to me that anyone would ever believe such claptrap. It's also, and I want all you Freemasons, and I know there are a lot of Freemasons who listen to this program. I want you to understand that when you go to your Masonic temple, you're not learning what you think you're learning. If you really want to learn, if you really want to get some truth, go to Ralph Epperson. Come to me. Listen to this program. When you go to the temple, you're being misled. You're being led around by a ring in your nose. You're being lied to. And unless you reach the highest degrees, and even then, unless they can trust that you believe in the same God and the same philosophy that they do, you're never going to know the truth. You're never going to know anything. For the whole structure of pyramidal organization of Freemasonry and the other secret societies, this is not the only one, ladies and gentlemen, and you know that if you listen to this program. The whole reason for that structure is to keep you in the dark and form a basis of power built upon your oath to protect the fellow members and the brothers and give them aid and comfort and on all of the other things that you've sworn to upon pain of death. This is what gives them the power to destroy this country, as they are doing, as you're hearing, as we've proven in their own words. Okay. And we're going to continue right now.
Let's continue on with this third attack on Hermann Biff. It, meaning, according to Rex Hutchins on page 66, it, meaning this blind, unreasoning mob, fears the force of the intellect. What does that mean? Man's mind, man's reason, and seeks the destruction of the products of the mind. What does that say? We're saying we don't want you to think that killing is desirable. We, this blind, unreasoning mob, feel it's wrong for you to think that way.
Well, they twist it around, and what they will tell you is that we suppress knowledge and wisdom, and thus the ability of man to evolve, which is all a total lie. That's really not what they really mean at all, and this will be proven in their own words as we go along. But just so you'll know, that's their defense of this. That's what they claim that we do. In reality, we have nothing against knowledge. In fact, if you've been listening to this program, you know I live to learn more every day. I'm always striving to learn. And most people who are intelligent and understand the reason that they need to do that will do the same thing.
Okay. So the last sentence that I'm going to read from page 66 is this one. He says, Hiram is killed at the east gate by a blow to the head, the seat of the intellect. So what he's saying here is that we, the church, we, the religion, we, the government, based on the fact that God taught us to punish murderers, etc., and create government to do that, are wrong. We have killed Hiram Biff. And later on, I don't have it here maybe, but someplace else maybe we'll stumble onto that. They claim that Hiram does not represent a man, but all of mankind. So now, in fact, I'll probably wait on that. I'm going to point out that they committed themselves to the murdering of the murderers of mankind.
He's also the symbol for who they claim, everyone in history who was persecuted. Galileo, Jacques Vimalet was burned at the stake. And there have been times in history, folks, when the persecution by the church and the king and the uneducated mob has brought about the death of brilliant men. But that's not the case today. Mm-hmm. Nor has it always been the case, nor will it always be the case. But these are the excuses they use for why we cannot rule ourselves, why we should not have any say in anything, and why they want to destroy the church, the state, and the mob, and of course, the mob is us. They want to establish their own one-world religion, which will change according to the needs of man. They will establish their own one-world government, a what they call a benevolent despotism, which is going to be a one-world totalitarian socialist government, and they want to subject all of humanity, save them, to slavery, perpetual, forever slavery, so that we can never challenge them in any way, shape, or form.
Okay. Next, the next page I want to read from Mr. Hutchins' book is page 73, just one sentence from page 73 of the book entitled The Bridge to Life. He says, "The Master Hiram," meaning Hiram Abiff, the Master Mason, "is the symbol of intelligence, liberty, and truth. And the assassins are the symbols of tyranny, ignorance, and intolerance or fanaticism." So here he's saying, when these Masons talk about liberty, they're talking about liberty from what they perceive is the tyranny of the God who tells us don't do certain things. See, you're not free if God restricts your freedom. Why does God restrict our freedom to murder? Why does God restrict our freedom to steal?
Well, they believe that these things are learning experiences. If they rape someone, then it's a learning experience. If they kill someone, it's a learning experience. They don't even believe that anyone should be subjected to prison, much less be executed for murdering their fellow man. And go ahead.
It's
unbelievable. I don't know how these people can believe that they could live with other men with no restrictions upon anybody whatsoever. Aleister Crowley, his motto was,
"Do unto I've got that quote. I think.
Do as thou wilt shall be the whole of the law." That's what he wanted to bring into the world. Do as thou wilt shall be the whole of the law. I would like to have seen what he would say if someone decided to do as thou wilt upon him.
Well, I asked. I know, Bill. That shows, in my opinion, the stupidity of these men.
Oh, yes. And they claim that they're so brilliant, that they have the only truly mature minds, and yet they are so stupid in their philosophy to think that the world would be a better place under that kind of law.
I found a quote from Ernest Hemingway that says, "I know only what is good is that which gives pleasure, and that which is evil is that which gives no pleasure." Something to that effect.
That's right.
And so I would love to have asked him, he's dead now, but I'd love to say, "Mr. Hemingway, let's presume that someone believed in what you just said, and they have a gun in their hand, and they walk up to you, Ernest Hemingway, and say, 'Mr. Hemingway, it will give me pleasure, therefore being a moral act, for me to shoot you. And I'll really enjoy this.' What would Hemingway say?"
"Oh, by all means, if it gives you pleasure, please shoot me."
Exactly. Do you see the stupid Bill? I know, you know, you and I are laughing, but I'm telling you, this is the way these people think. We're not joking.
I know. In one of the oaths they take, in one of the highest degrees, they pledge not to seduce the wife or daughter of a fellow Mason. But in that pledge, it leaves open the fact that they can seduce any other woman in the world that they want to, as long as it's not the daughter or the wife of a fellow Mason, provided that they know that they're a daughter or a wife of a fellow Mason. Which means that if they don't know that it's the daughter or wife of a fellow Mason, it's okay to go ahead and seduce that woman. I mean, these people are absolutely out of their mind.
I want to make one more point, Bill, about what you just said. Every Mason in this country has taken that precise oath.
That's correct.
Every one of them. The Christian Mason has taken that oath. The Buddhist, the Hindu. That they're giving them permission to commit adultery with their non-member wives. It is ludicrous.
And that's not all. They truly believe that they have the right to rip you off any time that they can rip you off, in any way that they can rip you off, simply because you're not one of them. As a Mason father of a friend of mine told him when he asked his father why they were persecuting a businessman in the town who was not a Freemason. The Freemasons were actually running this guy out of business. His father looked at his son and said this, "Son, if you are not one of us, you are nothing." Can you imagine that?
Well, they
can you imagine that, hearing that from your father? Or saying that to your own son?
Well, I know that you feel that you and I'm not a parent, but I know you are, Bill, and I know you know what that means, how stupid that is to say. But that is precisely what they believe over and over again in their own literature. They teach them that they are the superior masters of the rest of mankind.
That's right.
It is this whole thing, and you know, it's almost inconceivable for us to understand that the average mind can comprehend this. But that's what we're trying to do, is bring it to your attention.
Keep that thought, folks. It's time for our break. Don't go away. We'll be right back after this very short pause. There was a warrior named A. Ralph Epperson, and tonight he's right here with us talking to you.
I was there. That's me. Okay. By the way, thank you very much, Bill. I want to thank you once again for inviting me onto your program. This is very kind. It's a great opportunity to make this stuff, this information material public. We've got to do this because I agree with you. There's something going on, and we've got to figure it out to put a stop to it.
That's correct. It's my pleasure, Ralph. We've been friends for a long time. As you know, we very seldom get a chance to be together like this and to talk to so many people. Usually we're talking to a room full of people or a stadium full of people or a theater full of people, but right now, at this moment, you may not realize it, Ralph, but you're talking to approximately 10 million listeners worldwide. In every country, in every city, on every continent in this world, we are reaching out, talking to people, and you are delivering a message that is so important, and that's why they tune in to this show.
Well, I hope that they realize that this problem is not just local. It's not just confined to America. This is indeed a worldwide problem, because if America is going to fall into this ancient mystery religion, it's going to be worldwide, because we're the key to it.
Oh, they've heard that from me many, many times. If America falls, you all fall. The fate of the world hinges upon the American people's ability to keep their creator-endowed rights and restore the Constitution and the Bill of Rights as the supreme law of the land. If we are not successful in doing this, then the world is going to disintegrate into a state of chaos, racial wars, and even, I believe, an atomic war which will kill billions of people all across this planet. So keep your eyes on America and listen to people like A. Ralph Epperson.
Okay, let's take the next step, which is another giant leap, but once again, we're trying to bring you the materials from their own literature, Masons who have written on the subject that we know are qualified to write for the Masonic Lodge, experts that have been approved by their own the Grand Lodge, the 33rd degree in Washington, D.C. I want to now go to page 819 of Morals and Dogma, written by Albert Pike. And this particular quote is for the Mason who's listening. Mason, you're not going to like this, but I'm going to tell you that you are being lied to inside the lodge. And I'm going to tell you that Albert Pike is going to tell you that personally. He's going to speak to you on page 819. He's going to tell you that they're intentionally lying to you. They're keeping the truth of the secrets of the symbols from you intentionally. I want to read now from page 819 of Morals and Dogma. Any Mason who's listening worldwide can get a copy of this book and open it up to page 819 and read the second paragraph, which I'm now about to read. Quote, "The blue degrees, which as you and your listeners, Bill, I'm sure know, are the first three degrees of the Masonic Lodge. The blue degrees are but the outer court or portico of the temple. Part of the symbols are displayed there to the initiate. But the initiate is intentionally misled by false interpretations. It is not intended that he shall understand them, but it is intended that he shall imagine he understands them. Their true explication, which means understanding, is reserved for the adepts, the princes of masonry."
That's right. And I get letters from master masons all the time. The highest they've ever obtained is the third degree. And they write me letters telling me that I'm wrong, that they know all about Freemasonry, and what I'm telling couldn't possibly be the truth. Well, I hope that all you master masons are living, and I hope that you're listening to what you're hearing tonight. And if you would get into your own books, the books written by masons, for masons, published by Masonic publishing companies, and open your mind, open your eyes, open your brain, and quit being so stupid, you wouldn't have to be told by us what it is that you're a part of. You are really a part of the worship of Lucifer, the sun, the light, Lucifer.
Let's take that next, Bill. That's not pleasant either, but let's take
that
next.
Not pleasant, but that is your God. You've been conned. You've been lied to. And I get letters from Master Masons telling me that Freemasonry is really a Christian organization.
Okay. Well, let's talk about that. Let's talk. I want to now prove the assertion that you just made that Lucifer is the God inside the church.
Go for it.
We're going to now read page 321 of Morals and Dogma. The second paragraph, quote, I know this is difficult. This is not pleasant. In fact, let's lay down the foundation for the non-Mason. During the rituals, the first three degrees, what they call the Blue Lodge, the Mason is asked by the Grand Master in charge of the meeting, the president, we call him, they call him Grand Master, what do you seek? S-E-E-K. What are you looking for? What do you seek? And the Mason responds in the first degree, light, L-I-G-H-T, in the second degree, more light, and in the third degree, further light. Now, to my knowledge, I cannot find inside the ritual what they describe, what the meaning of light is. What does it mean? I've seen it called the truth, and that's about as far as they go. So the Mason is asking for light without a true explanation of what it means in the ritual. Mason, who those of you that are Masons know that what I just said is true. You know you were asked, what do you seek? And you personally responded, light, more light, and further light.
And they are, in fact, hoodwinked when they are asked this question. And hoodwinked, and that's where hoodwinked came from, which means to pull the wool over your eyes, or fool you. They are blindfolded, and when they are asked what it is they seek, if they reply the light, then the hoodwink is removed from their head, and they are, in fact, given light. Now, they take this to mean exactly the physical act of removing the hoodwink and receiving the light in the room, when in truth, that's not what it means at all.
Now, we're going to prove that, Bill. This is, please, Mason, I trust that you will write this page down, get your copy. I'm going to read you two quotes from Albert Pike's Morals and Dogma, the first of which is on page 321. 321. Open the book up and read along with me. The second paragraph reads, quote, as follows, Lucifer, the light bearer. Lucifer, the son of the morning. Is it he who bears the light? Doubt it not. Where does this light come from, Bill? Inside the Masonic Lodge. They just told you.
That's right. Doubt it not, he said. Which means Lucifer is the light.
It comes from Lucifer. Now, let's confirm that on page 324. 324 of Morals and Dogma, Mr. Pike repeats what he just said. He says they're talking about a belief in a devil, the fallen Lucifer or light bearer.
That's correct.
There he confirms that Lucifer is the light bearer. You, as a Mason, have just asked for light from Lucifer.
And who is Lucifer?
The Satan, the devil, in the Bible.
And he confirms it himself in his own book, in his own writing.
That's true. Now, I want to give you one more quote about Lucifer being the key to the Masonic Lodge and the Light Bearer from another book written by a Master Mason. Well, in fact, this is the 33rd, like Albert Pike, another 33rd degree Mason. This is the book called The Lost Keys of Freemasonry on page 48. Manly P. Hall was a 33rd degree Mason who died a couple years ago, and when he did, the Masons acknowledged him as one of the greatest philosopher writers of all time in Masonry. Let's now read page 48 of The Lost Keys of Freemasonry. By the way, I want to point this out because there are people who have come to me and say, wait a minute, Ralph, that book was not published by the Masons. That's correct. It was not published by the Masons, but it was written by a 33rd degree Mason. I have in my possession a copy of the Royal Arch magazine several years ago that said this book, The Lost Keys of Freemasonry, was on the recommended reading list for all Masons. So even though it wasn't published by them, it's recommended by them. And if those who want to see that, I have a copy that I'll send it to you. You can read it with your own eyes. This book is recommended reading for all Masons. Mason, if you're listening to me right now, write this down, The Lost Keys of Freemasonry, and read with me along on page 48. Quote, when the Mason learns that the key to the warrior on the block is the proper application of the dynamo of the living power, he has learned the mystery of his craft. So how many mysteries are there? There's only one. And the mystery we've just repeated is that Lucifer is the light bearer. Now let's read what Manly P. Hall says about Lucifer. Quote, page 48. deceiving energies of Lucifer are in his hands, and before he may step onward and upward, he must prove his ability to properly apply energy.
That's right. I hope you listeners understand what it is we're doing and the great risk we're taking by doing this. I have been personally threatened, and I've been told that if I don't shut up about Freemasons, and specifically about Freemasons acting in leadership capacities in the patriotic community, that somebody's going to get hurt, and that somebody's going to be me. I'm going to tell you right now, if anything ever happens to A. Ralph Epperson or me, you take our dead bodies and lay them on the steps of the Masonic Temple in Washington, D.C., and then burn it to the ground. Go ahead, Ralph.
Okay. I want to now read from 567 of Morals and Dogma. Once again, another quote to talk about this being Lucifer, known as the Lightbearer. Let's go back now to our recollections of what we read about in the Bible. I didn't quote the Bible, but let's just talk about the Garden of Eden, where God told man that you can eat of any fruit of the tree. Anything that I gave you is yours, except the knowledge of the good and evil. That reserves to me. I will tell you how to live your life. And when you do, you will live in paradise. If you will listen to my laws and my rules about not killing and not raping and not looting and not stealing and not coveting thy neighbor's goods, etc., all laid out, you can live in a paradise. No, the Masons say those laws are tyranny because they restrict our freedom. And they have reversed it. I want to read now from page 567.
But before you do, I want to say something. If the world were really like that, and if everybody really obeyed those laws, we would, in fact, really be living in paradise.
There's no question about it. Why? Because we'd be free. You're totally free.
That's right. No one would live in fear. No one would be hurt or injured. No one would be sad. Everybody would be living with enough and with their own property and in happiness without fear of their neighbor or anyone else.
Okay, now let's go to page 567 of Morals and Dogma by Albert Pike. Quote, to prevent the light from escaping at once, the demons forbade Adam to eat the fruit of the knowledge of good and evil. Bill, according to Albert Pike, who's the demon?
The demon is the God that created mankind, according to them.
Yes.
Now, according to their own story and their own philosophy, the Creator, God, the God of the Bible, is the devil, the bad one.
Right. Well, we're going to continue reading that.
And they claim that Lucifer is the light, the good one, who give man the freedom by encouraging them to eat of the fruit of the tree of knowledge. But if you understand who came first, you know that Lucifer is not God.
Right.
Lucifer is the great deceiver, the liar, the manipulator, who has hold of the souls of these people who are lost in the pit of Freemasonry.
Okay. Let's go back. I want to read the whole thing in its all of it together. It's one long sentence. Let's listen. To prevent the light from escaping at once, the demons, meaning the triune God, the God of the Bible, forbade Adam to eat the fruit of the knowledge of good and evil, by which he would have known the empire of light and that of darkness. He obeyed. An angel of light induced him to transgress. Now, notice what he just said.
Mm-hmm.
The book of Genesis says the serpent appeared to Eve and Adam and induced them to transgress. The devil induced them to transgress by violating God's law about not knowing yourself what is right and wrong.
That's correct.
The God of the Bible is a demon. And Lucifer is an angel of light. Once again, Mason, you remember that you personally asked for light from the... You did not know you were asking for light from the light bearer. It's now been confirmed three times by Albert Pike in his book entitled Morals and Dogma.
Isn't this absolutely amazing that these people are so easily conned? And go through their whole life sometimes believing that they belong to a Christian organization just because somebody opened a Masonic Bible and placed it up on their altar inside their Masonic temple.
Mm.
But if you go to India and walk into a Masonic temple, what do you see on their altar? The Bhagavad Gita.
Mm, I don't know that.
It's the Buddhist, the Hindu text. Whatever those people believe is what you're going to find on the altar. So the Freemason who says that Freemasonry is a Christian organization is fooling is really a part of it. He's fooling himself as well as others, as well as being fooled.
Now Bill is making a statement based on the evidence that we have just given you. I'm reading from their own literature published by the Masonic Lodge. There's no question about this. If any Mason doubts me, check it out like you've been pleading with them. Open up the book, Morals and Dharma, and read it yourself.
That's right.
I'm not making this up. It sounds like it, and then we say, oh, you Masons worship Lucifer. Oh, that's impossible. No, we just showed you in your own literature. Okay, now let's go to a book called Clausen's Commentaries on Morals and Dogma, also published by the 33rd Degree Council in Washington, D.C. Henry Clausen used to be the successor to Albert Pike, maybe five or six men later. I mean, he was more modern. He's the more, like, he was just replaced a year or two ago.
He was the sovereign grand commander of all Freemasonry for several terms, I believe.
Yeah, quite true. I don't know if they have terms or not, because I think they lived for...
Well, they must have terms, because I noticed the same name is listed for several years in a row. It may be for life. Maybe it's because they were appointed and then they died, and they're listed for several years. But in Mackey's History of Freemasonry, you see Clausen's name covering several years as the sovereign grand commander of all Freemasonry, of the Scottish Rite.
On page 75 of his book entitled Clausen's Commentaries on Morals and Dogma, meaning the book Morals and Dogma, Clausen, now the successor to Albert Pike, is writing. He says this on page 75. The true knowledge of the one supreme deity is given, meaning given inside the Masonic Lodge.
Mm-hmm.
Notice, they're not teaching about the God of the Bible. They just call him a demon.
Yes.
So who are they teaching about? Who is the one supreme deity?
Lucifer.
Lucifer. You know, Mason, I can only beg of you, if you're listening, please check this out. What are you involved with? If this is new to you, I beg of you, open up your literature, read these books, these citations we're giving you, check it out, and then get out. Wouldn't you agree, Bill?
Save yourself, because I'm telling you right now, there's going to be a big battle sometime in the future. If we can't solve this problem through legal, lawful means, then we're going to have to resort to the last legal, lawful means that we have, which is outlined in the Declaration of Independence, which is to take up a gun and take our freedoms back and our country back. The purpose of this program is to try to prevent that, because I don't want to see it happen. But if it happens, all of you people who have been oppressing us for so long and distorting the truth and taking our Creator endowed rights away from us, and you are the same people who have manipulated us into wars and created the wars and done all of the terrible things that I can trace throughout history, you're going to pay a terrible price when the people finally go to wreak their revenge upon your head. And it's coming. There is no way to prevent it unless I'm successful, and Ralph is successful, and others are successful in waking the people, empowering the people, and being able to do this before it comes to that. But what kind of odds will you give me that that's going to happen?
Well, you know, Bill, I'm like you. I don't like to think about that. I'm trying to educate my whole...
You have to think about it.
Okay.
We've got to stop it. That's the part.
Okay. Bill, you can think about that. I'm thinking about education. My whole life has been dedicated, well, at least my last 30 years of my life, been dedicated to producing materials that people can rely on. Good, legitimately, well-researched, well-proven, well-documented stuff you can read and know that's true. And I've tried to make that available. I'm hoping that everyone listening today will just take the time to look at the catalog.
But the purpose of that, and you know this as well as I do, is you know that if people don't discover this and learn it and act upon it, there's going to be blood running in the streets of this country.
Well, Bill, once again, I'm not going to say that. You can say that.
Well, right? That's a cop-out. That's a cop-out. You know it, and I know it, because you know that's going to happen if people don't wake up. We're either going to be slaves, and they're going to kill millions of us, to wreak their revenge on us, to have their one-world totalitarian socialist state. And that's what happens whenever socialism takes over anywhere. People are sent to labor camps. They're sent to death camps. They are executed by the millions. You know that.
Well,
we all know that.
I'm not here to advocate violence or...
Well, you see, that's the cop-out. You're afraid that if you acknowledge that that's going to happen if we don't stop it, that you're advocating violence, and that's not the case. What we are advocating is that people wake up and stop this before it happens, and that's not advocating violence.
Okay,
that's bringing them to their senses to prevent the violence. That's what I'm all about.
Okay. I hope that people are trying to get a sense of urgency from both of us. We're not talking about these things happening 47 generations generations now. In fact, in my book, I found out what their date was. I made it public in 1985. That's 8 years ago. I found out what their target date is. It's the year 2000.
That
doesn't give us much more time.
I found out the same date in my own research and put that in my book before Ralph Epperson and I ever met, or we had either read each other's books. Mm-hmm. And we were amazed that we had discovered the same. Mm-hmm. The same thing.
Okay, now let's go up to the externalization of the hierarchy, once again by Alice Bailey, the New Age of, she's almost a Mason, she could certainly qualify. Let's read from page 511 of her book called The Externalization of the Hierarchy. She's going to talk about Masonry. She says, the three main channels through which the preparation for the New Age, and Bill, I'm sure your listeners know what that is. Those of you that don't know, we're talking about the New World Order. It's also called the New Age in certain circles. The Masons call it the New World Order. We're talking about the change of our civilization. It's called the New Age or the New World Order. So the three main channels through which the preparation for this coming New World Order is going on might be regarded as the Church, the Masonic Fraternity, and the educational field. The Masonic movement will meet the needs of those who can and should wield power. Wait a minute. We just learned these Masons are Luciferians, and she's telling us that they're the ones who should, who can and should wield power.
That's correct. And if you look at the organizations that most of the people who are leading our government, our Congress, and even in your cities and states, you'll find that they belong to the lodge.
Yeah. Okay.
They do wield the power.
She goes on to say, it, meaning the Masonic movement, is the custodian of the law. It is the home of the mysteries and the seat of initiation. It holds in its symbolism the ritual of deity, capital D, deity, and the way of salvation is pictorially preserved in its work. The methods of deity are demonstrated in its temples, and under the all-seeing eye, the work can go forward.
Okay. By deity, they mean the process of apotheosis, whereby man himself becomes God.
It is a far more occult organization than can be realized. Now, Mason, did you hear that? Mason, someone just told you your group is far more occult than you can imagine, and intended to be the training school for the coming advanced occultists. The word occult means that which is secret and confined and restricted to a certain group of people. Can you understand what she just said?
Oh, absolutely.
Masonry is leading us to the New World Order, in addition to education and the New Age, I guess, those three channels. The Church, meaning in this case, she's talking about a lot of good Christian pastors, etc., fundamentalists who are leading us this unknowingly. Okay, here's once again another comment about the secrets inside the lodge written by Albert Pike on page 772 of Morals and Dogma. He says, if you desire to find and to gain admission to the sanctuary, meaning the inner works of the lodge, we have said enough to show you the way. If you do not, it is useless for us to say more, as it has been useless to say so much. Mason, he's telling you, read the book, figure it out, and then get out. That's what this is all about. We've got to get out of those of you that are Masons have got to get out.
That's right. We're running out of time. Folks, I want to make something very clear to you. Sitting here and educating you about the New World Order and what's coming and ignoring the fact that what this is going to culminate in, if we're not able to stop it, is bloodshed and violence, is absolute stupidity. And I won't be a part of that. So I'm not advocating violence. You all know that. The purpose of this program is to wake everybody up so that no violence will occur. However, I'm going to tell you, if we're unsuccessful, millions and millions of people are going to die, they're going to be enslaved, they're going to be put in slave labor camps, and if you want to see how these people really work, go back and look at Russia, the Soviet Union, right after the Bolshevik Revolution, look at what Hitler brought into reality in the world, and remember that these are the exact same people, and understand that if you want to live a good life and have a good future, we've all got to get together, wake up, and put these people under lock and key where they belong and make the future of the world a good one, living according to the laws set before us by God that can ensure a safe, secure life for all of us. A world without morals is a terrible, terrible, terrible place. Good night, and God bless you all. We'll be back with Ralph Epperson again Monday night.